Okay, on to the next part here. A little more about Simple CV. You can get a lot of image properties through Simple CV, so if you want to do special things like change the colors, analyze it, all that stuff in the image, you can get all that through Simple CV. You can do image manipulation in there. Tons of stuff. It's really powerful. You can even mark up those images, write text on it, draw on it, whatever you want to do. It has feature detection, and this is really why it was built. It wraps that open CV library, and you can look at the image and you can find all the edges. You can find the blobs in there of certain colors. You can do all this sort of advanced stuff with it. And depending on what sort of application you're building, that could be very useful to you.
Facial recognition?
Yes. Yes, it'll find faces, yes.
It's in there. Will it recognize them?
That's a separate problem. Simple CV will find a human face for you. It will not recognize it for you. Let's put it that way.
How do you compare Simple CV with OpenCV?
Basically, I believe all of OpenCV is available through Simple CV. If it's not, you can just sort of go behind Simple CV and use OpenCV. So it has OpenCV plus other things that it wraps. We're not going to do any of that today, unfortunately. So the next part of the talk is GPIO. I have here, you may have noticed, a small breadboard connected to my Raspberry Pi, and it has something plugged into it. But first we'll talk about what is GPIO, just in case anyone doesn't know. To present your own pie. So a general purpose input output. Basically it's a set of pins on the board that you can hook into different things. You can hook them up to sensors, you can hook them up to other devices such as Arduinos, you can hook them up to motors and servos, and some of them provide power. And you can use these to do a lot of stuff. On your Raspberry Pi, this is hard to see, but it's in one of the corners. Just looks like that. Looks like a bunch of pins sticking. And it's changed a little between versions. So this is the Raspberry Pi. Oh, that was A, but I guess it's the B. And in the B Plus, they've actually added a bunch more GPIO pins. So that's one of the nice things on the B Plus. You can see some of these provide power, 5 volts, 3.3 volts of power. You've got a bunch of ground pins, and you've got a bunch of GPIO pins. So those are what will let you get inputs and outputs. So what I have up here is this black cable is hooked to my GPIO ports on the Pi. And it goes to this thing here, which is called a Pi T cobbler. And that's basically just a little board that lets you plug your pins into a breadboard. And usually you'd use a breadboard when you're setting up a circuit, just because it's a lot easier than trying to hook up to individual pins with other pins. So this just makes it really easy to hook up to the breadboard. It mirrors the pins from here to here and then to each of these spots, and they're labeled so you can see what they are. If you come up and look at it later, you can see that. It's easier to tell what each pin is. And here I have, this is a passive infrared sensor, motion sensor. I think it was like $6 at Radio Shack, not very expensive. But what it does is it looks at the scene, and if it sees any motion, any change, then it says, okay, I saw a change. It sets one pin from low to high. That's all it does. But it has like 130 degree field of view, so we're gonna get like constant motion here unless everyone's a stay. So to help you work with GPIO, there is a Python module that wraps it and makes it easy. It's called the rpi.gpio Python module. I think it comes pre-installed on the Raspbian distribution, so you don't have to install it. It gives you access to those ports. The best place to start with this is the examples on SourceForge. And it's kind of a strange thing, but you need to use sudo to use it, because I guess to access the hardware at that level, you have to be in access. So if your thing doesn't work, it yells at you, hey, you probably should use sudo. So we have a couple demos of this. I'm just going to run the test first. Here, I'll do this quick. Notice I'm not doing sudo here.
What sensors do you have connected right now?
I just have that one passive infrared sensor, the PIR. See, so if you don't use sudo, you get this message.
You don't really want to change.
Try running as root.
Arms on dev mode.
I'm not that brave. And on something like the Raspberry Pi.
What are the types of sensors that you use? Pressure, or motors?
With the Raspberry Pi, I have used a button. I've used some LEDs, I think a thermal sensor with it, but it'll work with pretty much anything you can find.
Coupled with motors is that
we'll get into that a little bit later. Says okay, it's high because I saw motion. Low, hey, there's motion again. So this one, when it sees motion, I have it sleep for 5 seconds to wait just a little while before it tries again. That. Not too complicated. So I'm just using the time module here. You import GPIO from that RPI GPIO library. You have to specify which sensors you're using. So I'm using pin 7 on this board. That's one of the GPIO ports, or pins, sorry. You have to set the mode for the board. Not too clear on what that is. But then you have to set for each pin, you have to say whether it's an input or an output. So here I'm saying this is an input because I'm reading data from that sensor. You can set the pull-up value on that. Here we're just going to loop, sleep for 0.1 seconds, look at the state. If it's the same state, then don't do anything. If that state changes, right, we're reading the state from the pin here. So if that state changes, then we say, okay, it changed. So real simple loop to read from that infrared sensor. So now we're going to use that sensor with the camera. And it won't take long. It waits for motion and takes a picture when there's motion. Since we have a lot of motion here, it won't take very long to find that. Uh-oh, Eric. Took a long time to tell me that.
Yeah.
Here we go, and we're initializing the camera. Hey, I found movement. Took a photo. So it does it. Again, it's through a loop, so every time it sees motion, it's going to take it.
How do you detect motion just from the camera?
What's that?
How do you detect motion just by comparing to the camera?
Yeah, simple CV will let you do motion detection from the camera. It'll it'll compare two images for you, and you can decide if there's, that's part of simple, well, it's part of OpenCV, so you can access it from CVC. Right, so we took our pictures, we got the motion sensor that triggered the camera. And so now the sort of culmination here. Let's see how this works. It's the security cam. So what this does is it's similar to that where it waits for motion. If it sees it, it takes a picture and then it does a 10-second video.
Yeah, I just saw that.
See how this goes. We might have trouble with the video part again. So it took a picture and then it's recording that video. I think it's 10 seconds. It might only be 5.
43 seconds.
Yeah. Last time it was 43. Although it's interesting, I might have used a different video size because it's not. The CPU is a peg this time, so if I used maybe a small enough video, there, yep. So I used a smaller video size on here, so it makes it
work. So earlier you were showing that you could have two different cameras.
Yep.
And use multiple cameras. Could you use one for just like a basic something, and then if you wanted the high quality, have the other one turn on if they're like pointed in the same direction?
Yeah, you can use the trigger one to independent of each other and do whatever.
Or use the low quality one to detect the motion and use the high quality one to actually record the video?
Yep, you can do that. I kind of like the infrared sensor for motion,
yeah.
Just because at night that works well. But then this does not work through any kind of window.
Yeah.
Which I found out, it took me a while to figure that
out. How are you going to have a course with a couple cameras?
Glasses okay, dude.
Well, I have a splitter up here, a USB hub. You can do the same thing. You do start to run into power issues when you have too many USB things plugged in here. Like right now, I'm sort of on the edge of the power that's provided.
So how do you have the power issues?
If you have a powered hub, then help a lot. I don't have a powered hub.
You can run or power the Raspberry Pi on the powered hub.
As long as it provides enough power.
Yeah.
You have to make sure that it provides the, what is it, one?
I think it's like 850 milliamp, but that's if you're not using it. I'm using, on USB, I have a Wi-Fi adapter, and I have keyboard and the mouse and the camera all hooked up. And I was having some trouble with it, and that's because I was using like an 850 milliamp adapter. So I went and got, I think this one's 1.3, and it just barely powers this stuff. I can't really plug
the
keyboard in anything.
Camera.
I think the laser mouse.
The Wi-Fi really.
The Wi-Fi, yeah.
Yeah.
So you do have to worry about power when you get a whole bunch of stuff playing. So the code for the little security camera thing there is pretty similar. We've got our camera and our video stream, like recording a video. Did we forget to look at the same video? I think we did, but that's all right. Our GPIO library. Or camera setting. Yeah, so I used a smaller camera here, that's why the video saved. This particular camera and the Pi works at 15 frames per second with a tiny little video. 10 seconds, I'm just using that same sensor, pin 7, to read from the motion sensor. So here I'm just setting up a file name based on the time. We got the board. Initialize the camera, and we've got a real similar loop to last time where we just sit there and every 0.1 second we see if the state of the sensor changed. If it does, we get that still image. So we go and find the file name with the PNG extension and save that out. And then we start up the video, we get the file name with the AVI extension. A video stream. I think we can skip this, so I'll go over a little more. The video stream object is what sets up the video for you. Not necessarily streaming, but it works real similar to the images where you give it a file name and based on the extension it tries to guess what codec you want to use. You can use like H.264 and sometimes it'll work. AVI seems most reliable in my experiments so far. As for successfully recording the video and playing it back. So then we're doing the same thing here. We set up the frames. In each frame, we get an image, and we write it to that video stream. And then we wait, and we get the next frame, and we wait 5 seconds and see if there's more motion. Start back at the slides here. So, as know your name, but as you mentioned, motors and that sort of thing are kind of finicky. And the author of the RPI GPIO module says, if you're after true real-time performance and predictability, buy yourself an Arduino. Because as you can see, it's pretty easy to peg the processor on the Raspberry Pi doing other stuff, rather than, you know, doing what you may want it to do. So I just wanted to talk a little bit about how you can connect an Arduino to your Raspberry Pi, and then that Arduino will handle all of the sort of I/O stuff for you. And it'll handle talking to motors better, it'll talking to sensors in a more real-time fashion than you might get from the Raspberry Pi. You can use empty battery.
I've seen the other options, let's say going up, level up to, let's say, vehicle bones, where you can actually let the motor and that impact given to the kernel of the vehicle bones OS and
okay.
Recommendation to more reliable.
Cool. Yeah, there's a lot of competitors now for the Raspberry Pi. And almost everyone I talk to says most of them are better than the Raspberry Pi.
Except for the video is still best than the Raspberry Pi.
That video, the Raspberry Pi video game is really good. Yeah, so you may want to look around at like BeagleBone Black. There's like a dozen easily that are competitors to. Raspberry Pi has the momentum just because it wasn't actually first, but it was the first popular one. I think is it 4 million? Raspberry Pi.
Sold 4 million.
3.2, 3.3
million been sold. So
that's pretty good.
They have a lot of them out there, and they have a large community. So they really have momentum, even though it may not be the best board. So the other thing you can do with Python and Arduino is you can connect it over USB right to your computer using these two libraries. These are more Python libraries that make it easier to use those things. So if you want to go beyond what you're doing with Raspberry Pi, this may be the way to go. We're not going to do any of that today, though. I have a couple of slides with more information, with links to all the stuff I used today. The Raspberry Pi, the infrared sensor, the cobbler that hooks up to the breadboard, and the book Getting Started with Sensors, which I really like that book. It's very useful, so whoever wins that is lucky.
GPIO, right? How do you talk to sensors like Spybus or I2C or something like that?
Those are available. I have never dealt with them.
There's a SPI module, so I've actually connected a CAN, an MCP2515 on there, and there's a fairly high, well-supported SPI library, and some peripherals either have modules or there's a Python version for both that. And I think there's one for I2C.
Yep. Okay.
Yeah, both buses are on the 2016. They can either be GPIO or I2C or SPI, depending on how you just have to put the bit somewhere.
Nice. So a little more about SimpleCV, the website. This is a book, a very good book on SimpleCV. So if you'd like to learn from books.
There's also a new one.
For SimpleCV?
It's an OpenCV with Python.
Okay. Yeah, that might be a good one too. I don't know if they'll talk about SimpleCV, but all right. And then my code is available on GitHub, and the slides are included in this repo. So if you want to go back and review all this, it's just a PDF. It's in that repo.
And sources?
Yep, all the source code is from all the files. We just
did. Well, can you wait there for a second?
Sure. So that finishes my talk. Any more questions? Yes?
Do
I know it's a long drive from Grand Rapids to come out to do this for us. I really appreciate you taking the trip. Thank you.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Coming in
the direction you came from, you'd be fine.
Real
yeah.
question though.
Oh, okay.
Where's the best way to find and get yourself a Raspberry Pi with the things that I'm going to need so that I can start doing some of this?
I like Adafruit for online.
We also have a local place called Micro Center. It's at
14 and I-75.
Yeah, 14 and I-75. It's got a whole bunch of stuff. I mean, they have a whole section.
Yeah, they've got a really good.
Pies for $30 now.
And they actually have
B plus is $30 there, by the way.
It's mostly
well, time I can't hear everybody.
B plus is $30 at Micro Center.
Really?
Where is it?
Yes.
Where is Micro Center?
Yeah. I-75 and
14
miles. Mile.
Yeah. The south east corner of 14 and 75.
Long lines.
Yeah. Any time of the day is a long line.
Yeah. Yeah. I always get my stuff online and then go the quick checkout.
Which is still slow, because everyone else does that too.
It's still a lot quicker than waiting in line.
Yeah, true.
Yeah, I don't know any place in Grand Rapids where you can walk in and buy a Raspberry Pi. You can get Arduino stuff.
Yeah.
Like you say at Media Shop, but that's about it that I know of.
I've seen people calling it Raspberry Pi and Arduino.
Ours has a section about as big as this podium. That's all.
Yeah, that's the Rat Shack.
It's got about 40 of those sections for each little thing you can think of, right?
I got a comment.
Yeah.
My favorite book on the Python is Python for Raspberry Pi by Sams. It's about $30. It's the best Python book I've seen.
Huh.
I'll put a plug in.
Yeah, I haven't heard of that book. How old is that one, you
know? I just got it a year ago.
Does it teach Python 2 or 3, do you know?
Python 3, exclusively.
Okay.
2013.
Wow, that's cool. Cool, I'll have to look at that one.
So I just sent out a link on the email group indicating that I found a site that does own cloud on a Raspberry Pi.
Yeah. There was a tie-in, yeah.
I actually have that podcast saved for my ride home. Linux Action Show covered phone clouding here. That was Chromebook.
Well, they did own cloud a few months ago.
Yeah. Yeah, this was cloud.
Okay.
All right,
excellent. Thank you very much.